Welcome, everyone, to Visual Storytelling. Today's session is all about unleashing your creativity with your writer's brain. My name is Shelley Hayduck, and I'm co-hosting today's event with Matt Caton, our Director of Customer Solutions.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. And I think I'm going to start the creativity right off the bat with a quote from Shakespeare. Can't get much more creative than that. And I'll tell you a little bit later in the webinar today about how this ties in with everything that we're demonstrating today. So my quote comes from Shakespeare's sonnet 122. Thy gifts, thy tables are within my brain, full charactered with lasting memory. It probably makes sense, but Shakespeare can be a little tricky, so I'll share with you exactly what that means during the webinar today. It's going to be a really fun webinar. Thanks for joining us.
All right. Very nice. Very inspiring words. And inspiration is a very important aspect to this. And so is creative incubation. So what I want to do is talk about how to kickstart your writing projects. A lot of us might be in this scenario where you have a document and you don't know how to get started. So it might be once upon a time in a galaxy far, far away, announcing the great product of the year. Okay, so that's great. We have a product brochure, press release, a new chapter to write. What now? What happens when our creativity needs a jump start? Well, sometimes we get writer's block. So what I want to focus on is how the brain can help you be that place to inspire you and to make creativity a little bit more accessible by visualizing all those great ideas that you have when it's not time to write that brochure, and things that inspired you in the past that can help leverage you to get to that galaxy far away or that once upon a time story. So with that, I'm going to close the document and jump right in to my writer's brain. So the brain enables you to make an infinite number of connections. You can map out ideas, documents, information. It can be used simply as a knowledge base for ideas you have, or you can actually use it for document management and hardcore research if you're a journalist or a researcher at a chemical or pharmaceutical company. So lots of possibilities here. So right now I'm in my writer's brain, and what I want to do is give you an overview of idea incubation from a writer's perspective. So I'm just actually going to go to our standard mode here and orient everyone to the writer's brain. Now, pieces of information in the brain are what we call thoughts. And a thought can represent any type of digital information. So I've just clicked on my writer's projects. And here we can see I've got good writing projects. I can launch this Word document. I've got some journal articles. I've got research here as well. So each one of these can have documents connected to it. We can also go ahead and link web pages as well. So I've got a section on writing essays in my writer's brain, and all I have to do is click on that URL, and it's actually going to launch some stuff on from a university on how to write a good essay and style and thesis. So in addition to adding all your projects in the brain, any kind of writer's guides that you need, references online to styles, these can all be linked in together as thoughts. Now, one of the advantages of the brain is that you can have one piece of information effectively located under multiple categories. So here we can see the writer's brain connects me to my writing essay section, but I have that under grammar. And in my grammar section, and what writer's brain would not be complete without proper grammar, I've got all kinds of references. And I just want to give you a sense of, you know, what you can put in this brain just to make it convenient. So we have an efficiency component to your writers or project brains where you're literally just putting in references so that you can keep that flow. If you need to look up a word, reference the style, citation, all there. But then at the same time, move into the creative space. So for instance, here's a website on a list of logical fallacies, so things that writers do that sometimes don't always make sense. So when you see these articles and you think, God, I can't remember that article. It talked about this. Where is is that you look and if you store it in your brain, you kind of always have that for reference. So this is a full writer's section. This brain is actually published on the web. More than happy to share it with all of you. But what I really want to get into is also creativity and building a section in your brain, in your digital mind, regardless of what industry you're in. If you're not a writer, if you're a product designer or maybe a software engineer and you just happen to be on this call today, these same principles can really be applied to any brain. So you have the utilitarian information resources integrated with some inspiration. So let's jump over to that section. So I also have in this brain things that I'm inspired by. And creativity and inspiration are intimately connected. So as a writer, what I put in this brain, and this brain in particular is geared to fictional writing. I have another example that we'll get to later on that's nonfiction. But it has different writers that have had some significance to me. So for instance, I can click on Edgar Allan Poe and I've got links to his works. I've also got images, some very evocative images, and these images are very helpful for me. So if I am looking to write a script with a little bit of a dark nature to it, I can always kind of check on what Edgar Allan Poe did or what Mary Shelley was working on, and I use these visual images in addition to the web links. I can actually go ahead and click on this Wikipedia link to read about the murders in the Rue Morgue. It's all right here in my brain. So one of my inspirations is Joseph Campbell. And Joseph Campbell wrote an amazing book called Hero with a Thousand Faces. For those of you that are into script writing and, you know, most of the Disney movies, for instance, Christopher Vogler, who's a literary consultant, this is all sort of based on the heroic journey. So now what I'm doing is I'm sort of the theories that help me become a better writer, I'm actually visualizing these things in the brain. So the heroic journey is under elements of story, and I also have it under the creator, Joseph Campbell. And this journey, Joseph Campbell was a key influencer for George Lucas as well. So you can make connections. That's why I have George Lucas as a child. So you can see the way these connections come together in just a fascinating way. Now, what I've done below the hero's journey is I've actually used the child thoughts. So these are thoughts under my active thought, and I've numerated them for sort of the 12 phases of the heroic journey that the main protagonist goes through in a story, from the ordinary world to the call to adventure to meeting the mentor to all these steps. And so what I can do is I can actually, as I'm writing my nonfiction work, I can go through these steps and make sure my story has all these. It's actually very similar to project management, where you can map out your project management steps as well. We do a lot with, you know, government workers, but in this case, we're doing it in a more creative setting. But these principles of nonlinear but logical organization can really be applied to any concept. And of course, we have, I love the zoomable icon. So rather than just having the diagram of the hero journey, I actually have a link to that. And of course, from there I can continue. There's some other interesting links. So we've got The Heroine's Journey, which is a more recent spin on it by Maureen Murdoch. And sort of looking at these things helps set the tone for me to go ahead and create my next story. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to my writer's projects, go into the fiction area, and I'm going to create a new story. Now I have an area here for short stories. In this case, I want to start a novel. Not exactly sure on the name of it, but I'm going to call it The Blue Rose. So I've just created a new idea in my brain. Now we have some wonderful tools below the thoughts to also help you with ideas. So I've made a note here, The Blue Rose, and I'm just going to start saying, I like this name, but what could also be interesting as a name is Where the Horizon Ends could be another possible title. So I'm just going to remember that I'm going to call the story The Blue Rose for now, But this particular idea, where the horizon ends, I'm also going to jot that down just in case my editor or when I have a friend read over this, they think that's a little bit more of a cliche. We'll go ahead and do that. And now what I'm going to do is just start mapping out and doing a brain dump into my brain, because that's the best way to get these projects going. If you happen to be a movie producer or a casting director or somebody who does more live story or creative projects, this is also a great area to go ahead and drag and drop any casting resumes that you'll have for actors and feature films and things of that nature. We're based in Hollywood, so we actually do have a lot of concept designers, script writers, and producers who do use the brain to bring together a number of elements. So in this case, I'm going to start off with character development. And I actually have a document on my desktop that I can go ahead and drag and drop in. So I've got a folder for some of my writing projects. And one of the things I want to add into this brain is a character study that I have. So I'm simply going to drag and drop that document. And what that does is that creates a shortcut to where that document is in this folder. Now I have a couple options. I can leave it in this folder, but in this case you can see my brain syncing right now. I'm actually syncing my brain to the cloud, to my iPhone, to my iPad, to my home computer. So I actually want to, I can do one of two things, move this file into this brain or copy it. In this case I'm going to move it. Now you'll notice in the thought tab below, which is very important here, it will always show you the path as to where that document is stored. And that's very important for writers, because we're going to talk a little bit about document management, because, of course, what's a writer without a big pile of Word documents that needs to be organized on your computer? So I'm right with you on that. So let me go ahead and move this file into the brain. So you can see now I'm sunsetting that folder, and I've got it stored internally into the brain. Now, the other thing I can do is I can attach a brand new document and just start my writing project right here. So, for instance, if I just want to start the story, I can right-click on this thought and select to add an attachment. So, any attachment, any file that I have registered on my computer. And, of course, I'm going to do Microsoft Word document. I'm going to minimize this one, and let me just start the blue rose will be set in the southern U.S. And just any ideas I have. And I'm going to go ahead and save that. And that actually gets saved right back into my brain. Each thought in my brain actually has a thought folder where that document is. In fact, it's very wonderful, the diversion control in the brain, because I can always add notes. So, for instance, let's say I've come back to this a week later, and I want to add something about three cool female characters. But I want to save the first version. So now what I can do is actually go up to File and hit Save As. And it's just, I just want to go to the current folder. Each folder in my brain has a unique folder identification number. You don't really have to know this, but I just want to reassure you that there's nothing magical about storing a file or a document in the brain. It's just another folder on your machine. So in this case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to rename this document the Blue Rose 2 and save that. And I'm going to close that. I'm also going to close this other document that I don't want to save here. And what you can see on this thought is I've got the little number 2 by the icon, and you can see below that as well, I've got two versions of the document. So that's the way you can go ahead and use the brain for version control. The other thing I can do is I can come in here and say version 2 incorporates more character ideas. So I can actually take notes on the document. So when I go to that particular area, and that's kind of the way you kind of get started. The other thing I want to do now for my Blue Rose is I want to go ahead And brainstorm, I want to have a setting, so I'm going to go ahead, and I'm going to use something called the comma trick, where it takes the, because I have other stories in my brain that have a setting analysis, I'm going to just hit comma and write setting, and that's going to make sure that this thought is unique to the blue rose setting. And so when I click on that thought, you can see it says blue rose setting. And I actually have an area in my brain that I'm going to activate to help me sort of, again, figure out where I want to set this story. So I'm just going to go ahead and do a search for setting in my brain, and that's under elements of story. And I've got some interesting places. I've got the haunted stairs, which of course you can see I'm using as my background. I've got a castle, I've got a bunch of things. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to this idea of haunted stairs and some major event happening on a staircase. I like that. So I'm going to take haunted stairs and link this back to the blue rose under blue rose setting. And now I've got that connection there to that particular setting. The other thing that I'm thinking about is, I mentioned the South. I visited Savannah, Georgia, and absolutely loved the city. So I have a thought in my brain already, which is interesting. I didn't know that. And that's the cool thing about the brain. As you're typing, you'll have something in there. It could even be for 2 or 3 years ago that you forgot about. So it's kind of intriguing. So I'm actually just going to connect to this to see what this is. Okay, very nice, an old colonial house. Okay, very good. So that's a reference that I took. I think this is actually a picture of a haunting tour I did 4 or 5 years ago when I was at Savannah, Georgia. So this is really good. This is helping me. This is helping get my creative juices going. Now what I'm going to do is use the brain's search web feature to go and do online research to further research if this setting makes sense for my story. So I'm going to go ahead and use that search web. And I've got all kinds of information. So I'm going to do Savannah, Georgia, and make sure I get the right Savannah here. And I want to do, let's say, haunting. I know we've done a bunch of haunting tours, so I'm actually just going to put that in because that could be really interesting fodder for my story. And of course, there's lots of ads on this and different websites. So this is fine. You know, maybe I'll even take a trip and have some fun. So I like these sites because they're going to have some folklore and some history to the city that I might be able to tap into for my story. So how do I integrate this into my brain? Very easily. What I simply am going to do is drag and drop from the browser address window and put it under Savannah. So I've got this Savannah Ghost Tours. And then let me go back and get a couple more. The Sixth Sense, how could I not add that one in? And we'll go ahead and drag and drop that into the brain. Now, a lot of you might be wondering how I got these wonderful zoomable icons in my brain to inspire. So I'm just going to go ahead and go back and do a search on Savannah, Georgia, and go to images. So now, look at how beautiful. Oh, I love these trees. So I love adding icons to any image. So let me just go ahead and say Savannah, the beauty of the city. Again, you can see I'm using that comma trick. So now I've got the thought, Savannah, the beauty of the city. And I can do one of two things. I can actually just go ahead and click on an image here and copy this image and just paste that. And it's going to go ahead and, oopsie, let me just go ahead and make sure I grabbed an image properly. So let me just copy this image and then come over here and paste it as a thought icon. And what you'll see is now I've got the zoomable icon. It'll actually zoom to the size of the image. If I want to go ahead and actually make the image a little bit bigger and look at that, I can copy full image, or I can use the brain's Snagit program. So if I want to go ahead and I just want to talk about Savannah trees, those beautiful trees, What I can do is now right-click on that thought again and select to capture thought icon. Now you can see I get these wonderful crosshairs, and this image is a flash animation, so I may not be able to copy. So I want to just grab the portion of the trees and the flowers. So this is the part I want. Release my mouse button, and there I've got that beautiful image of Savannah. And so this is becoming a theme for me, sort of the beauty combined with the haunting. So I'm getting some true inspiration. The other thing that this is sort of making me think about is, earlier we talked about Edgar Allan Poe, and he sort of has that same thing where he has a beauty to his stories, but they're also, of course, they have that darker tone to them. So I'm going to make a connection to this story. So now when I'm developing setting characters, I have references to some of these other things. And in fact, the fall of the House of Usher, that could be very interesting. So I'm actually, there's some things in that story that I like that I can relate to on the Blue Rose setting. So you can see how things are coming together. I've got different reference material all in a place. I still have my Word documents, but it's so much more than just a document. This is becoming a full knowledge base. Now, with the setting and the tone in place, I'm ready to do some character development. So I'm actually going to go ahead and add two characters in my brain. One of them is going to be Jill Branson. And Jill Branson is going to be sort of a young police officer. And then we're going to have Kelly Lawson. Now, Kelly Lawson is the older mentor in the story. So a couple things here. So I want to think about Jill Branson. I might attach a Word document or even just go into the notes area to make some notes on her character profile. New to the police force. Comes from a poor family. Eager to make her mark. Okay, so there's a few things on Jill Branson, and I'm actually going to bullet this list here right in my notes. So I've got that in my brain. So now when I'm in the story, if I mouse over Jill, I have those notes as to what kind of character. And this is going to let me go back to, I'm thinking of Maureen Murdoch and the heroine's journey, and I have a whole section actually on heroines. So this is another area that really takes advantage of our wonderful Zoomable icons. And again, this is just an area I put together from, we've got everyone here from Anne of Green Gables to like Sarah Connor in the Terminator movies and Disney heroines as well. So, and of course, what brain would be complete without Wonder Woman or Trinity from The Matrix? So you can see, again, having fun with these Zoomable icons, but fun for a purpose. So, in terms of who this character is most like, do I have anyone here? Maybe very similar to, there was a character on Alias by Sydney Bristow. So I'm actually going to link Jill Branson to Sydney Bristow. So that way now, you can see I have my notes here on her, but I also have a character reference that was done in another TV show that will take some elements and model. And thing about Kelly Lawson, when we go back to Joseph Campbell, so I'm just going to go ahead and Google search for Joseph Campbell in my brain, which here he is. Let me just resize this brain here so everyone can see what I'm looking at now. And in the heroic journey, there is the types of characters. There are character archetypes. There's allies, there's heroes. So of course, we could actually put Jill Branson as a hero I'm working on. So I'll put Jill under my heroes section. But the other character, Kelly Lawson is more of the mentor. She's going to be the mentor for the younger police officer here. So I'm going to go ahead and link Kelly under mentor. So now you can see where this theory of how story is should be written, and of course this is just one theory, comes into the reality of my story production. So I actually have some very interesting links now when I'm developing these stories, and that's the way that goes. So I think this can give you a good sense of how to get started and how the brain can make you more creative. Now, the other thing you might want to think about is how to pitch your ideas. If you are a writer looking to secure funding or to produce a play, so the brain is wonderful for visualizing ideas, as you can see. And so what I'm in right now is standard mode. What I can do is I can turn on my distant thoughts and go to see a little bit more. So you can see what this looks like. Another view that I really like is outline view. Now, outline view is very interesting because I can go ahead and look at different areas. I can open up all my stuff on Edgar Allan Poe. I can go ahead and look at everything in this brain in more of a linear fashion. And this might be a nice way. We probably have a number of teachers and students and our educational users on this call today, I imagine. So outline view is fabulous. And in fact, if you wanted to do a full story visualized in the brain, you could then switch to this outline view. And again, it's just plus and minus, expanding and contracting all these brains. You can see, and I can flip through all these really cool different, animated or not animated all the time heroines in my brain and kind of get an overview of things this way. And the other thing that you can do, of course, if I go back to normal view, is you can use the thoughts to actually do sort of visual performance art. So sometimes I will actually map out poetry. So an example of that is Robert Frost, one of my favorite poets, so The Road Not Taken. So here we've got the actual poem. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. So in this case, I'm doing a timed click through of my thoughts, and I'm doing it in a way that I don't want to see everything all at once to add suspense for my students if I'm teaching a class, for you, the audience, who's listening to me narrate that poem. So that's another way you can kind of present ideas when you're pitching, whether you're pitching a new advertising campaign for that big client or trying to get you secure funding for a blockbuster movie. The brain will inevitably get people's attention. So that's one way to do it. And then the final view of the brain that is absolutely wonderful, let me just go back to the home thought, is our expanded view. Now, what expanded view lets you do is customize where all the thoughts are on your display. So I'm going to select new expanded view. You'll notice how the brain sort of moves. And now what I can do is I can take the writer's section, move that over here, script writing, I'm going to take elements of story, emphasize that, and really blow this area up over here and put characters out here. And let's get this whole section on the character archetypes that Joseph Campbell sort of coined. And actually clicking that thought actually brings the emphasis there. And then this looks pretty good. I'm actually presenting in a very low resolution just to keep the web meeting nice and responsive for all of you. So this looks fabulous. Large screen monitors, dual monitors. So go ahead and play with this. And then when you get a view you like, let me just bring it together a little bit tighter, all in one area here. So this is kind of cool. I like this view. I can actually go up to options. View, and save expanded view. And I'm just going to call this the archetype view. And this is great, too, because maybe I'm meeting with a fellow writer or project manager, and all they want to talk about is more script writing and character archetypes. So regardless of where I am, let me see, I'm back in normal view. Maybe I'm just back talking in my writer's resources area. I can always go up to view and load that. You can see I have a number of different views here, but let's just go back and load the archetype view, and boom, there it is. So again, you're kind of ready for action, whether it's the genesis of a story, the production of the writing material, to the presentation. And again, there's no limit. Now what I want to do before I pass presenter to Matt is I just want to go to a more practical example for those of you that might just be project managers wanting to add a writing project into your brain. So I want to show you how you can integrate just one writing project in a larger brain. So let me just go ahead and go back to normal view. So this particular brain is just a brain on everything. So as you can see, you can do topic-oriented brains. The brain that I just presented was a brain completely dedicated on writing. Now in this particular brain, writing is just one of my responsibilities. So here I've got an active project area where I'm going to go ahead and add a project, and that project will be my new company brochure. So I'm just going to go ahead and add that in the brain. The other thing that's really great is I can set up thought types for different projects. So if I want to right click and I've got some different, this could be considered a critical project, a cool project, you know, maybe it's not a funded project or a green lighted project. So I'm going to make this a green lighted project. So now my new writing project is ready to go. And of course I'll bring up the tools area here. And I've got some calendar items appearing as well, because again, this brain is sort of my brain for everything. Now what I'm going to do is I'm simply going to drag and drop some resources. So I have that writing projects folder. I have a company brochure that I want to reference, a previous one. This is an older one. So I'm going to go ahead and simply drag, and I can drag on top of this thought if I want to connect it to the thought, or below if I want to create a separate thought. In this case, I'm going to create a separate thought, and I'm going to go ahead and activate this thought and go ahead and move that file into the brain. So I've got that, and let me just drag and drop a couple more documents. Now I can actually drag and drop full folders as well. In this case, I'm just going to go ahead and do our product brochure. And again, drag that, and in this case, I'm going to make a copy of that file. So I've got some existing reference material. Of course, I can start a new document just by right-clicking and selecting to add that attachment. In this case, I'll start that Microsoft Word document, and I'm just going to go ahead and save that so you can see. So now I've got that document there. And the other thing that I can do is link to existing stuff in my brain. So we're actually, this new company brochure is going to actually be influenced and take on the theme of our new company website redesign. So I want to make a connection from all this stuff to my new company brochure. So let me connect that. So now you can see this new company brochure project is not only under my website redesign, but also under my active project. I've got links to other materials. I can also go ahead and make connections. I know that Jill is a great writer, and also so is Jim. So I'm going to connect Jim to this project as well. So what I'm doing is I'm sort of building connections around a project and leveraging past projects as well. I can actually go into the marketing area of my brain. And I've got all kinds of, let me just dismiss all of these here, all kinds of past writing projects that I can reference. So for instance, I've got this advertising content that I want to look at, as well as company background. So I'm going to make a connection to this this new advertising content. So I'm just going to go back to the company brochure and connect that there. So now you can see that, and actually, new company brochure. I've got the new advertising content that I worked on. The pat, and actually, probably want to rename this to, this was a 2015 company brochure, just to clarify. So I've got the links to the 2015 company brochure, new advertising content, product brochure, and all that can come together very nicely in my brain. And if I ever want to search for all my documents, the reports are a great way to do that as well. One of the things that you can do is, of course, I can go ahead and look at everything that I've modified by date activated, but in the reports area, I can actually go ahead and search by attachments. So if I want to look at all my, well, my dot docs or docx, I don't know which I have more of, I'll just do dot docs. You can see everything, all my documents in the brain. This is also particularly helpful for writers as well. So you can see my press releases, my products page, my press release strategy, which is a Word document, all kinds of really great content. And the brain will not only search the names of these thoughts, but the content. So if I just wanted to do a search for services, for instance, and search the content, you can see that it's giving me thoughts, but it's also giving me web pages and documents that have that keyword in. So once your writing projects and your documents are in the brain, they're completely indexed and searchable as well. So that makes referencing past projects really easy. And I think with that, unless there are any questions, Matt, I'm going to pass presenter over to you. And it might be Shakespeare time now. I don't know.
I think it is okay. Shakespeare time. The brain that I'm going to share with you is a little bit different. I'm not going to be creating any new stories from scratch. Instead, I am studying the work of Shakespeare. So thus, the Shakespeare quote that I shared with you earlier ties in nicely. And a person could spend their entire life studying Shakespeare. Many people do. I'm not a Shakespeare expert by any means, but an enthusiast nonetheless. And so this is my Shakespeare brain that I'd like to share with you and share with you some of the features of the application that really helped me to better understand Shakespeare, his work. I've read Shakespeare since I was, I guess, in high school, but I've never understood it the way I do until in recent years that I started developing the Shakespeare brain and compiling all of my learned resources together. So let me take you on a quick tour of the brain. Obviously, I have in this brain the complete work of Shakespeare. So all of his comedies, his histories, his poetry, tragedies, and sonnets are here. I can just click on one. So I'll go to comedy and right down to Midsummer Night's Dream, one of my personal favorites. You see I've got some character studies down below, links to recent movies about Midsummer Night's Dream. Quite often, and actually let me click back up through comedy and literature, right up to Shakespeare, I have Shakespeare thought linked to Othello. So Othello falling under tragedy. Again, character study down below for individual characters. If I click on the attachment, I'm going to open up the complete Othello script, line by line. It's all there, his complete works, all in one brain. And this is something that you could gather online. Can I go online and research and find a copy of Othello and read it? Yes, I certainly can. But I've got my own personal character study. I also keep a synopsis down in the notes section of the brain. The reason why my default thought, my home thought, Shakespeare is linked to Othello, is because I have tickets to Othello coming up next month, and it's been a long time, I'll be completely honest with you, it's been a long time since I've read Othello. I have a vague memory of what's going on and the dispute between Iago and the different characters who are falling in love with one another, but what really helps me, even as an enthusiast, is to go through and read my notes, and I've got notes on each individual play that Shakespeare has ever written, so that if I am going to an actual stage production or to a movie, I always like to read my synopsis, and it just really helps me even follow along. It can be difficult at times, so it helps me follow along with the script. I can rent the movie. I think this is Othello starring Lawrence Fishburne. I've got a link to that, so I can rent that really quickly before I go, and of course a link to the Shakespeare. Independent Shakespeare Company, a company here in Los Angeles that's going to be putting on Othello in Griffith Park. So I'll do a little bit of research on them as well, all at my fingertips. Additionally, in this brain, in addition to his complete works of and character studies and synopsis, which I think is pretty monumental in its own, notice that Othello links up to 1603, The King's Men. Now, Shakespearean historians, let me minimize my notes down below, I've sort of categorized Shakespeare's life into different chunks of time, what was going on in his life, who he was working for at the time, what he wrote during those years. And it can give you a greater understanding. And this information can be hard to find out there on the web. And certainly by reading Othello, you wouldn't know that he was one of the king's men writing plays for the king. And the other amazing things, when you're writing for the king, you better turn out some good work. Therefore, Measure for Measure, Macbeth, King Lear, some really historic treasures that he wrote during that time. And it gives you a greater understanding of sort of what was going on. He was on his game when he was writing these particular plays. And another really poignant, great example of this, I'm going to fast forward in time, to 1611, around the time of Shakespeare's retirement. If you read The Tempest, a fantastic play. It's just absolutely wonderful. But you might just think, wow, here are these people that are shipwrecked, and in the end, they're set free, and that's fantastic. But when you realize that this is the last play that Shakespeare ever wrote, he's actually setting his characters free into the world. At the end of the play, I think I have here in the synopsis that the magician, could this be Shakespeare the writer, buries his book and his scripts and retires them and says farewell to his characters. That's Shakespeare saying farewell to all the characters that he's created, saying farewell to the stage, and maybe to even life in general. So a much, much deeper meaning of Shakespeare by mapping it out in my brain and keeping track of all the different components of his life. And also, a fun aspect as well. Obviously, I can rent the movie The Tempest if I'm going to go see The Tempest or want to be entertained. Great production done in 2009. But who knew that also The Forbidden Planet, Warning Will Robinson, is a direct, I guess, arguably copy. Oh, here I've got it in the my zoomable icon. An arguable copy of The Tempest, starring none other than Leslie Nielsen as well. And Robbie the Robot, I think. But it's The Tempest in space is what Forbidden Planet is. So sort of a fun take on The Tempest and a lighthearted one, obviously. And that's linked over into my movies. Notice all the different Hamlets there have been over the years. And I tag them with Kenneth Branagh and Ethan Hawke and Kevin Kline and so on. So just some greater understanding and a bit of fun as well. And this area of my brain under timeline, I'll share some information here for you as well, is where I keep track of Shakespearean resources. There's so much literature out there, and again, you can start learning about Shakespeare and all of his scripts from the moment you begin to read until the end, and still keep discovering new information. And it's hard for me even to read along just really quickly with the Shakespearean script. And so I've devised my own little dictionary, my own library. I'll just click on a random letter here. Shakespeare invented a lot of his own words. Words you'd be very surprised that we use today were actually invented, or at least first seen in writing in Shakespeare's works. And here in my notes section, I can really quick back and forth between a script that I'm reading and my dictionary to find out that Jack is not just a person's name. It's also a small ball when you're playing lawn bowling. As well as a figure that is struck on the bell in an old clock. So if a character is calling another person a Jack, they're saying, you're right on time. You're always poignant and to the point and always going to be on time. It's actually a compliment. So that can add some greater understanding to the script you're reading as well. Elsewhere in this area, again, I'm keeping track of new words that bloody, bump, control, countless. Simple words that we take for granted today, actually invented by Shakespeare. I can learn more about his writing styles, iambic pentameter. Again, different areas of the web where I found this information and simply kept track of them so I can go back and polish up my own skills and how to read Shakespeare from time to time. And, of course, one might think, why are you keeping track of Roman numerals? I've got my Roman numeral cheat sheet. That is actually because all of Shakespearean sonnets are always written out in Roman numerals, whether you're going from 1 all the way up to, I think it's 152 or 154. They're always written out in Roman numerals. And here I've got a quick link to CXX11 or II. That would be 122. And this is thy gift, thy tables are within my brain, full charactered for lasting memory. So again, everything that I've learned, everything that I've gained, it's within my brain. completely written out, full charactered, with lasting memory. It will always be there. So everything I learn about Shakespeare, I put in my brain and keep it in my brain so I can learn it again. So what a visionary to write that about our technology. So nice of him to give us a plug in some of his own work there in Sonnet 122. But a few other areas to share with you as well. Let me go back really quickly into resources. Again, the timeline is fantastic for me. I have a lot of fun with the Shakespearean insult generator, web pages that I just keep track of for humor, where you can generate a goofy Shakespearean insult. But also, I keep track of games that I play with my actor friends and Shakespearean historian friends, all the way from action figures that it can't get any more exciting than Lego action figures for Shakespeare, to actually really difficult games, the Bard game and so forth, some fantastic ways to be introduced to Shakespeare, to play Shakespeare and learn more about him. And also, under resources, an area for related authors. Now that I've gone through and read many of the Shakespeare plays, I haven't read them all, but I also study other authors at the time that may have influenced him or that he has influenced. And one of them, if you know a bit about Shakespeare, there's Thomas Middleton. There's even debate as to who wrote some of the plays. Was it Shakespeare? Was it Tom Middleton? Middleton, it's clearly debatable. And one of those examples is Macbeth. I think an Oxnard historian recently wrote an article that some of the phrases and portions of Macbeth can be directly lifted from other books written by Tom Middleton. So did Shakespeare grab those, or did Tom Middleton help out a bit with the writing of Macbeth? So let's go ahead and attach Thomas Middleton to Macbeth. So I just type in the first few letters, and the brain shows me there's Macbeth. I'll go ahead and link to that. But I'm going to have some fun with this particular link, rather than just a direct link. So yes, I can see Macbeth is linked to The King's Men. It's a tragedy by Shakespeare, but now it's also linked to Thomas Middleton. But let's define that relationship. Maybe I just want to click on the link and add a question mark. Did he help write it? Maybe I want to go one step further and add what we call a one-way or a directional link. So what I'm going to do is notice when I click on a link between two thoughts, I can actually define the relationship between these two thoughts. So I can type something on the link label, or I can even leave notes on the individual link. Another great, great way to add context to the creative brains is to further define the actual relationship between the two. Notice that he clearly co-authored The Bloody Banquet. So I can click on that and see that script was co-authored between Thomas Dekker and Thomas Middleton. I don't have to go down and read my synopsis to find that information out. The brain is letting me know. So here on my link between Macbeth and Thomas Middleton, I'm going to set up a specialized feature in the brain, a one-way link. So rather than just leaving the link alone, I click on one way, and I can change the direction of the arrow. Notice when I click on the arrow, I'm toggling up in the brain back and forth which way I want to point the arrow. So this is a one-way link. When I see Thomas Middleton, I'll see that he potentially had something to do with Macbeth, and I'll even color code this link so it really stands out. And I could label it, did he help write? So a little tip for myself, did he help actually to write Macbeth? Or I'll just say co-author. So I can change that at any time. And I'll go ahead and save that. And notice that when I click down related authors, there's Thomas Middleton, and I can go right to Macbeth, obviously. But if I'm studying my literature and coming in from tragedy, so I'm coming at this thought from a different angle, and I decide to click on Macbeth, remember I set that up as a one-way link. It's only going to show up when I come in from and approach that thought from the Thomas Middleton thought. If I'm reading Macbeth, I really just want to know more about Macbeth and the characters, and maybe even rent one of the old Macbeth movies, probably with Orson Welles, the older one, and a more recent one, Kenneth Branagh, most likely. But regardless, I don't see that link. It's a one-way link that's only going to show up for me for one direction. So there's many, many uses when you can use that in your brain. You want to see a link from one direction but not another. A more advanced feature, but one that helps us better understand the content once again. And so with this, I think I'll leave my information full charactered with lasting memory so I can always revisit this brain and show you one more quick example before we jump into the QA. And that's the brain that I have put together for keeping track of a hobby of mine, personal interest, children's books. So not only do I use some of Shelley's techniques to help me to see in the resources, I actually lifted some of these ideas from Shelley, where she's got links to different dictionaries and synonym lists, so I avoid writer's block, my resources area, spelling zone or rhyme zone, so I can keep track of what words rhyme with one another. But I'm taking a little bit more of a business approach here. I've never published a children's book. It's just a fun hobby that I have. But notice if I go to my current books, I've got book ideas and then current books, and one of them is, for example, Peanut Butter Betty Bumblebee, and I can keep track. Notice that I emailed out Peanut Butter Betty Bumblebee in my mailing number 2 all the way back from 2011. I would never remember that. That was a long, long time ago, and it looks like I mailed out 2 of my little children's books, Peanut Butter Betty Bumblebee and Run, Randall, Run, some fun books that I've written. Those went out in 2011 with mailing number 2. Who did they go to? No problem. I've got all that information down here in my notes. So these are the specific publishers and addresses that was sent to, that I was the book was sent out to. I don't want to bombard them with an additional mailing here 5 years later. So I'm going to keep track of that and realize that when I start putting together my 2016 mailing list. I want to get this out again, but I don't want to have any repeats. So again, full charactered with lasting memory. I know exactly who I've sent these different books to, and I won't repeat that process. I'll send them to a new batch of potential publishers and continue on here in my brain writing new fun stories and keeping track of my progress along the way. And I think with that, Shelley, we can open it up for questions. Should we share your phone on speaker for the questions?
Yes, I want to make sure. Okay, I think we're on speaker. Yeah. You're
great.
Very good. And I'm just enjoying the Q&A because people are actually telling me what their projects are.
Oh, great.
So we'll get started on that and go right into Q&A. Christina is actually doing a PhD dissertation, just getting started on his work. And Keith is actually doing an autobiography based on the construction industry. So mapping all kinds of stuff in the brain. There's no limit. And again, this can be one brain for everything. A couple of you had asked earlier, you know, how you get started. There is one brain in the template section that I think would be very helpful. I don't even know if you want to create a new brain or and show this, but it's the brainstorming brain. And that also shows you how to brainstorm and has a more theoretical approach on creativity.
Great, and I'll just take the topic of construction history since that came up. And notice that we've got several different brain templates to choose from. And just check this box as you're creating a new thought. If you want to merge this into an existing brain that you're already happy with, but you know you want to merge in one of our templates, you can click on File, Import, and there will be the same list, these template brains. I'm going to start a new one from scratch. I'll select brainstorming, and you'll see how quickly my brain actually pre-populates with something we didn't talk about too much today, thought types, thought tags. Those are different attributes that you can apply to a thought, subjects or categories. Thoughts that typically would be linked to one another, a friend versus a document that's due versus a project you're working on, an idea you have. 4 thoughts that wouldn't be normally linked together, but they share a common thread. They're all a top priority, or they're all your current focus. So you can utilize those thought types and tags by identifying those. So here we are. My brainstorming brain has been created for me.
Yeah, and so there's the whole brainstorm area, principles of outcome, directed thinking. I guess you can just click through a few thoughts. I don't want to spend too much time on this, Brain, but it is on topic for a lot of you when you're thinking about idea generation. There's a lot of great stuff in this, Brain, on, you know, how to brainstorm, how to do more work. So do go ahead and reference that, Brain, as well. And then speaking of kind of inspiration, there are some, a couple questions on visual presentation, wallpapers, compliments on wallpapers, how to set wallpaper. And then somebody asked earlier, I think you responded, on the zoomable icons, how do you know how far that icon itself can zoom out? And really, the way that works is it's going to go out to the furthest width of the image. But Matt, I'll let you address that and maybe cover some window dressing on the creative brain.
You'll notice in my children's brain, here in Shakespeare, in Shelley's brain, the mysterious staircase, the wallpaper can actually emulate and enhance your brain experience. It's not really just for looks alone, it can also remind you of which brain you happen to be in. If you keep more than one brain and you're jumping back and forth from your business or brain with a real techno evocative wallpaper of life in the big city, the fast lane with lights, and then you switch to another brain that's all about camping and you've got a little stream and so forth. So the brain can actually sort of pull you into the mood and talk about creativity. This is a great way to be creative and enhance the brain and make it a digital reflection of your own organic brain. So here I've got the quill and the well with the book for my Shakespeare brain. I can very easily, and here I actually have some examples, sort of thinking ahead, knowing that this question was going to come up. There it is. So here I've got a nice picture of inside the Globe Theater. So this is online. I can right-click and copy this image and come right into my brain. I right-click on the background and paste wallpaper. So when you've got a JPEG or a GIF as your on your clipboard, you can right-click on the background of the brain and easily change that wallpaper. Now you notice it's got the blue sky there that blends in with my blue links. You can so easily go into your options and preferences. And here again, it's on the brain tab, we can set up different wallpaper if that one's too busy or not happy with it. I think this one would benefit from a really quick change. I'm going to go from normal links to some really bright yellow links that stand out. And I'm going to minimize my tool tab down below and maximize the brain. And I think that's going to work out really nicely for me. I can even from the attributes or from the preferences change my default link thickness. So the links are a lot larger, bolder, and glow. A lot of options that you can do with the wallpaper to really get something that stands out and works for you. It doesn't just have to be off the web. You can choose images that you own. So here I've got saved some of these images. I'd say some busy examples to show you that you want to pick something with some more muted tones. I like this image. This is sort of great for a Midsummer Night's Dream. So I'm actually going to open up my browser, or I can navigate to this file.
And there's a wallpaper setting as well, too, where you can browse to the file.
Actually,
also,
let me do that just as a different example. Absolutely. So I will go right back into my preferences. And on the Brain Tool tab where we change the colors, I'll browse for the wallpaper, and I'm just going to go right out to my computer. And on my C drive, I've got my wallpaper directory. And right there in Shakespeare, so I've got Blue Day. Let's open that one up and say OK. And so perfect setting for a Midsummer Night's Dream. It'll take just a minute to load there. I think that looks really nice.
Very
I might
nice.
Stick with that one. But also I want to reference, in addition to changing the wallpaper, the zoomable icon. Like I said in the chat, a lot of variables. How big is the actual file you started with? How much screen real estate do you have open right now? And I'm going to show you an example. So let's say really quickly I'm putting together Othello. Maybe I'm doing the stage presence. So I'll use the comma trick again. That was popular on your demo. So I'll say comma. Stage setting.
And just to be clear, what the comma does, if you put a comma in front of a thought you're typing, it takes the parent, which is always your active thought if you're creating a child, so in this case, Othello, and so this thought will be Othello, comma, whatever your subject is. And that the reason that feature exists is because you want each thought in your brain to have a unique name. You don't want a bunch of thoughts with duplicate names, no different from your file folder system where you each document should have a unique name.
If I'm a stage designer, every thought, every play in this brain, there are quite a few, they're going to have a child thought called stage settings. And I might do a search in the future or run a report, and I'll see dozens of thoughts all called stage settings. I don't want to see that. I want to see Othello stage settings, Macbeth stage settings, etc. So I add the comma as I'm creating the thought. I can always come back later and just create stage settings and just add comma Othello. But if I add it at the beginning, the brain will append the parent name for me. So I click check, and sure enough, the full parent name. Our scientific name for this feature is context-sensitive naming.
Yes.
We like to call it the comma trick. So here I've got my Othello stage settings, and I'm just really quickly going to drag and drop. Let's say I like this, the castle on the hill. So I'll click and drag that right into my brain, and I'm going to show you two examples of how we can maximize those zoomable icons. So it was mentioned earlier that I'm really not seeing the full zoom on this large image. Well, notice I've got my brain a lot smaller now, and this area of my notes are taking up, and my thought area is a little bit smaller. So when I zoom on the image, I mouse over, you know, it only goes to about a 4x6 size. However, if I've got more screen real estate, I maximize the brain application. I minimize this little button in the upper right-hand corner can minimize your tool tabs, toggle that on and off, maximize the brain. Now I mouse over and I get a much larger zoomable icon. So all depends on the original image size and the amount of room that you have or real estate in the brain to maximize those zoomable icons. And I'm just hovering over the thought, not clicking in another application. Those of you with creative minds today and deal with a lot with images, zoomable icons is really a key component to creating a valuable brain.
All right, great. And what if I want to change my thought color and my thought background? That happens a lot when you're adjusting wallpaper. Can you?
Absolutely. So we can go into options and once again open up our preferences. And here on the, notice I was on the brain tab up above. There are a lot of customizations that you can do in the brain. Again, making it a digital reflection of your own organic mind. And here on the brain tool tab, when you're changing the wallpaper, sure, if I've got blue links and a blue wallpaper, my links are going to disappear. So I can change link colors. I can change thought colors. So I just want my individual thoughts, let's say, so thought text, to be an interesting green color. Now I may have some thought types that will play around with this, but there I can see this still showing up nicely. I can change the thought background instead of being sort of a white highlight thought background. I'll make those a dark. Oh, now we're getting somewhere. Maybe I'll change the thought text once again to something even lighter. So I've really sort of reversed white text on a black background as opposed to black on a white background. A lot of features, every attribute, the links, the nodes or gates on each individual thought can all be adjusted. And you can also, like I said, go to look and feel and change the way the actual thickness, so the default thickness of your links to make them really stand out, or I kind of like adding the glow effect. So again, just other ways to really make the brain represent your own desired theme, and these themes can be saved as well. So let's say I really like my Othello background. I'll say OK, and I want to keep this and maybe apply to other brains. So I'm going to go up to my options, and I'm going to save this theme as Othello. So again, I'm a stage designer now. I'm designing Othello as well as Two Gentlemen of Verona, a goofy comedy. And I want completely different look and feel in the same brain as I bounce around between the two thoughts. So I've got one look for this, and then when I navigate to another area of the brain or I'm going into other meetings with other producers, I can go up to my options and I'll load up another theme. I actually have a few Shakespearean themes here, so let's load up Shakespeare too. Well, it's perfect for Hamlet.
And that's the sort of standard, the black on white text on a black background.
Yes. Now, notice I've got thought types that are very dark blue. I want to change that now. So I'm going to, once again, open up my tool tab down below, And so for all of my plays, rather than appearing in dark purple, I'm going to go to my thought types. And my plays are no longer going to be dark purple. I'm going to change my play thought types to a nice, really light, bright yellow. That's perfect. So here I can go directly to the tragedy of Hamlet and the backgrounds, the colors, everything that I've set up really encapsulates the information of Hamlet. And once again, all the details about Hamlet that I know, when it was written, what plays have been done. Here again, we've got a little bit of fun, all of our different Hamlets, and of course, The Lion King. The Lion King, many of us don't even realize, is the animated Hamlet. So some fun with that area of my brain as well.
All right, great. And we are at the hour. For those of you that do want to be respectful of your time constraints, we are recording this session. We're going to go for a couple more minutes. Just answering a few more questions have popped into the Q&A. But again, for those of you that do need to go, you will be emailed a link to the recording. The recording will be published on the site. And email me if you want the writer's brain. Actually, if you want to go real quick to thebrain.com app, there is a version of that and a previous recording. We're happy to share that with you. And then we've got some great templates there anyway.
So thebrain.com/apps, APPS, you can also just log into our website, and under the support area, you'll see the link for application videos and templates. Not only are there some great apps or brain templates that you can download from this area as well, but you'll also see a recording of Shelley and myself actually demoing that specific brain and the features that we like about that brain. So here in the lower area, we've got our more business area apps up above and down below, personal organization and creative and education. And, of course, we can go right into writing and creative projects. And here, once again, we'll probably load up today's demo.
Yeah, we're going to update
this.
That.
But you can actually download Shelley's Writer's Brain, and you can download my Shakespeare
and
Brain.
And then if you click
well.
On the link, what I did is I published. We haven't covered this yet. We might go into overtime, but you obviously, when you sync your brain, I do this for my Writer's Brain because I actually share this with some writers, is I have this set to browse online. As well. So you can see Matt is now accessing this brain as a reader just to browse and look through this, and I can send everyone a link to this, or I can tweet this out as well. This writer's brain, it has some good resources and some of it's just examples, so you can get a sense. So you can use as much or as little of this as makes sense for your project.
This is great. And again, here I am on my machine, separate from Shelley's, and browsing through and seeing even changes that she made today and synced right up to the brain. So I can go into start exploring my own heroic journey for some of my characters and browse through the brain that she's creating and use those resources, those shortcuts that she had for avoiding writer's block and so forth, all right here in the web interface. Also, I can access brains that I create and sync to my own cloud account for my iPhone and iPad as well. We've got iOS apps and Android apps available as well for brains that you sync to your account.
And your brain is also published on the web, the Shakespeare
brain, right? That's
correct.
That's right. Yeah, the link was there on the apps, on the thebrain.com/apps to see my Shakespeare brain as well.
So we'll go ahead and tweet those links out and include those in our thank you notes. And then just a couple more questions and we're going to close the session for today. One's coming from Tom. When I have several brains, how can I link them into one master brain? So a couple ways and a couple features to quickly demo. First of all, you can link to other brains, but beyond that, you can also copy and paste and import thoughts from one brain to another and also merge brains. So it really depends on what you want to do, and so we can cover all three of those possibilities.
Absolutely. So let's say I have a friend that is studying Hamlet and I want to share with them this simple area, or maybe they're just studying Shakespearean tragedies. I'll go ahead and click on tragedies. And I'm running in PC mode today. Shelley is as well. So for us, this is a control click. If you're on a Mac, this is done with a command click. But what I want to do is take a segment of my brain. I don't want to share my entire brain. Maybe I've got proprietary information or just information that I know my colleague or friend is not interested in.
but they really need this tragedy area. In a business environment, maybe they just need the sales area or the customer area of my brain, but not the research and engineering area. So here I'm going to control click on this thought, and that adds the single thought to the selection box. I can meticulously control click on one thought at a time through my brain. I'll use a more advanced feature. I'm going to right click now on tragedy and select to crawl and modify selection. So now I'm selecting every child word thought. I'll say every child and jump thought for, I only want to go maybe four generations down. I'll say okay. And I may have even gone too deep. I think, so four generations, one thought. I have close to 100 thoughts that I've added to my selection box there. This will refresh in just a moment. But I'm going to right click and copy these thoughts. So I copy selected thoughts, and I'm going to create a new brain called Shakespeare Tragedies. Oops.
They're all tragedies. Are any happy?
Oh, there's some.
Yeah, brain on just Shakespeare happy
I should
stories.
Have, yes, I should have grabbed Shakespearean comedies. So Shakespearean tragedy, and even, oh, what a tragedy. I spelled Shakespeare wrong. We have that.
A travesty.
Travesty in my tragedy brain. So now I'll right-click on the background. I still have that information on my clipboard, and I can simply select paste thoughts. And, yes, I want to confirm. I'm pasting everything. My notes, all of the link types and settings, the thought types, the tags, all of the graphics and attachments are all copied and being pasted into this now segment brain of my much larger master brain. So it's going to take just a moment. I actually gathered quite a bit of information.
Because it's copying not only the thoughts, but all your thought attributes. So any thought tags, types, images.
File attachments.
It's all going to be there.
Yeah, so. On each individual thought, I actually have, like, let's go to Macbeth, for example. You know, the full script is there. So now they've got the full script of all these tragedies and so forth. So quite a bit of information that's been added into the brain. And to take this one step further, now that's how we take one brain and actually segment it into a smaller brain. We can also take an existing brain and simply click on File.
To merge.
And I'll do this with this brain now. So File, and I want to merge the brain. And I think I have an Edgar Allan Poe brain, but I'm just going to grab another example. Here I've got my Acrophile brain. So another maybe business example. But what it's going to do is it's going to actually, do I want to confirm? Yes, I do. It's actually going to go out and launch my Acrophile brain. It's going to open up. It's going to copy everything in this brain. I think I may have selected
So you can do multiple merges. And that's great for templates. You might want to merge my writer's brain with Matt Shakespeare's brain. And then the final question, which we do need to get to, that Tom originally asked, is how to link, like how to create a master brain that links to other brains too.
Absolutely.
So again, there's
sure.
the three possibilities. We sort of started talking out about copying thoughts to segment. That's pretty popular, especially if you want to publish like a select version of stuff on the web or whatever.
Sure. So here I am in my tragedies brain, and as you can see now, Acrophile is a part
Acrophile.
Of this
what
brain.
Is Acrophile?
This is a sample brain that I pulled up just to merge.
Okay. I was like, I don't know
together.
What that means. It's not related to Shakespeare.
So not related to Shakespeare. Just a business example here in my
Brain.
Yeah.
Okay.
And let's say I want to get to this company name from another brain. I can now right click. So this is the merging, not merging two brains, but linking. So I'm right-clicking on Acrophile and selecting to copy the local thought URL for this Acrophile area of my Shakespeare brain. Now I'm going to jump over here into another business brain, eSolutions, and we'll say that Acrophile is a new business that we are thinking of acquiring. So in my business brain, I'm going to go into my customers area and create a new area for potential clients. And I am entertaining the idea of bringing Acrophile on board. So, again, that thought URL is on my clipboard. I right-click and I paste the thought URL. And this is, now I have merged the two brains together. I've linked one brain to another. So from my eSolutions consulting brain, I can jump over and it'll go directly to the specific thought that I was on, acrophile here in my Shakespeare brain.
Great, right. So just to come full circle, Tom, on your question, see, there's two ways if you want to sort of build the mega brain. I wasn't sure if you wanted to just link to those brains within a master brain, so that's when you copy the thought URL. Or if you just want to integrate everything all together, you could do a bunch of merges into a mega brain. And by the way, speaking of mega brains, on March 10th, in a couple weeks, Jerry Mikulski, the godfather of the world's largest published mind map created by a single individual with over 288,000 thoughts, is going to be speaking. We just published the webinar on our in our newsletter. It's on the homepage. Go ahead and reserve a seat. There's going to be a lot of people attending, and it's a great example of somebody who has a very large mega brain. So do join us for that. And then going from the other extreme, real quick, before we end our session, I cannot go without answering Christina's question on the opposite. Do you outline how you want to connect thoughts, ideas, and content first, or jump in at the start? This is from somebody who is developing a brand new brain and is unfamiliar. So let's go ahead and take a new brain. I don't want to make this too much of a Brain 101 class, and I do want to let you know, Christina, we have the Brain 101 every Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern Time. Fabulous, fabulous class. We always start with a brain from scratch. So let's go ahead and start from scratch.
Absolutely.
On a new brain. Let's just call it our writer's brain.
Absolutely. Sounds good. And before I leave the brain, I just
wanted to show
that I actually have a link to Jerry's brain on the Shakespeare area of Jerry's brain in my own Shakespeare brain. That's how good his brain is. It's a valuable resource, even if you're studying Shakespeare. There's great information in Jerry's brain on that. So let's go ahead and start a new brain from scratch.
You can even call it Christina's writer's brain.
Sure.
And then I guess what I like to do, and it is funny because we're talking a lot about associative connections, but just getting started, I like to start with a base hierarchy and then make the connections. Now, you can, there's no right or wrong way of doing this, but maybe in Christina's brain, and this is where we can show you the semicolon trick, where we can create multiple thoughts with the semicolon. You can have short stories, corporate writing, new projects, team members, whatever else Matt wants to type in, and I'll let Matt kind of just do a basic quick start on a brain, just for those of you that are similar to Christina, just getting started. So again, that's just new brain. You start, the first thought in your brain is the name of your brain, and then you start sort of building downward, creating those topics or areas that you're going to further develop.
Great. So I've listened to a few of the words that you mentioned and typed them in as I went, and noticed that I used a semicolon. So let's say Christina is, sending out a lot of her works to some different literary agents. So there's agents in New York, agents in Los Angeles, agents in Seattle. And notice I just simply separated those with a semicolon. It's a great time saver. Creates individual thoughts for me all at one time. Let's say in New York, there's the agent Barb Smith. So her contact information obviously would go down below. Just leave a quick phone number for Barb. Oops. There we go. And let's go to a different area of the brain. So let's say these are some of her writing ideas. So she's got a book on entertaining. Maybe she is also studying, architecture, since we talked about that earlier. And thank goodness I have spell check, so I can always right-click and fix these. And let's say that Christina is also studying, relationships between people and cats.
All right.
So a couple of fun ideas. Okay. And maybe the relationship between people and cats, she is collecting quotes from friends. So she's got her quotes. She needs some cat experts, so vets that she's going to be linking to. She needs pictures of cats. And maybe she also just needs some scientific research.
Excellent. And then without going too far, let's start some cross-linking, getting back to your question. So see now what Matt has done really quickly, and again, we cover more of this in one, he's sort of built a fundamental hierarchy of all your key sections, your areas, and now this is where you could start interlinking. Maybe there's a book that's related to a vet or a building in the city of LA that has cats, so you can make some cross-connections.
Sure. So
as your brain develops.
Yeah. Paper on buildings with feral cats, or just buildings with feral. How do I spell that? Feral cats. Not F-E-R.
One R.
There we go. Feral cats. And this is going to go under her research area. So she's got ideas, her resources. So that's going to be the building. So I've linked those two. So whether she's going to resources that she's read from recently or the actual book that she's writing, she'll still be able to get to this great article, which is a great resource, which is providing more information. And also in a casual conversation with an agent in New York that she's trying to pick up, the agent said, well, I've got to get off the phone. I need to get home and feed my cat. That was Barb. So she's going to quickly link this to Barb. So she knows the relationship, and I'm clicking on the link between the two, has cats.
Ooh.
It was just a great little line that she picked up in a recent meeting, has pet cats. And she really thinks Barb is going to have an interest in this book that she's reading. So we've, again, linked two very distant thoughts to one another, cross-referenced those. Now it's time to start getting out on the web, pulling in information, writing down in the notes, start bringing this all together.
And
you can thought,
yep.
So in just 5 minutes here, we created about 20 thoughts that is the framework for the next great literary piece to hit the market, which is The Relationship Between People and Cats, written by Christina.
And you know what? We could go on forever. I'm so tempted to have Matt drag and drop some wonderful cat images, but we're going to stop it right here. We've gone from haunted stairwells to corporate brochures to Shakespeare to feral cats. I think we covered a lot of ground in today's session. I do want to remind everyone, the newbies, join us for the 101. We also have a recorded 101 class. Matt hosts it. Absolutely fantastic class. If you can join us tomorrow or any Friday, and then we have a big thinker event, Jerry Mikulski's 288,000 Thought coming up, brain seminar coming up in 2 weeks. You want to sign up with that. And on that note, I think we're going to close today's session. But before I do, Matt, any final words of wisdom for all our attendees who've gone, well, 23 minutes
yes.
past our hour,
well,
the surviving attendees of this seminar.
Thank you so much. This seminar, as you can tell, we've had a lot of fun putting it together. It's always our personal interest that we're putting out there in the brain and sharing with you. And don't be afraid to get started creating your own brain on your own interests and hobbies. You'll be amazed at how quickly you can put it together and actually start learning more about your own interests right there in the brain. And if you have any questions at any time, we're always happy to help, always available, support@thebrain.com. We'd love to hear from you. So thank you.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Hope to see you again on a future Brain Technologies event. Have a great day.